which we find into him. Now about his style. The slide says that he is having classical style because basically he is a cardinal and religious writing is presenting. No doubt romantic prose will suit because audience is very important and a clear-cut message should be given. But still, a man of religion and devoted to much, and mainly Bible is the book from where he gets the idea. So you will see that this man is having a deep moral message to convey, and that can be done through his prose writing. So his prose writing is found into a very great bulk. Look at this slide, friends. So you will see that classical style he is adopting, but because it is the moral tone of the age he wants to convey, and as a result he has adopted lucidity into his writing. Transparency of ideas in his presentation you will find. He can do that some of the things, he can make arguments, but there is also necessity to restrain oneself as a writer, so that a restrain and balancing also can be done. Now you also have in his presentation you will find that he is referred that in his writing you will find temper of the tone. I mean, what is the temper of the period that is given into his work? But because he is very clear to give the message, you will find that he handles the subject very well. Plain style, he almost perfected it, because ultimately readers are very important. They get the message, and whatever he says should reach to the heart. And that's where he has perfected his style. And another thing is that he is a master of ironical and satirical work. That is a different thing, because in religious aspect, irony and satire don't work. But in Cardinal Newman's work, that is found. And that we should also notice into his work. Friends, look at this slide now. You will see that there is a warm writing, oratorial style, and he is a rhetoric, but his rhetoric is not artificial because he has the experience of giving messages to the audience. And because he is a cardinal person, almost a correctness of his essays you will find like a professor writing or a university teacher writing. So academic correctness is found there. That is Cardinal Newman's writing. Now, friends, let us move to another leading prose practitioner that you see on the screen. That is Matthew Arnold, who was born in 1822 and died in 1888. Basically, he is known for his poetry. He is a leading poet of the Victorian period after Milton and Tennyson. But we should not forget that his literary work is also very, very useful and very important. Especially his critical writing has given us new ways. And that also gives that basically he is a person who is writing prose. And his poetry also, you will find, is drifted towards prose writing. Because the time was suitable for social change, and that social change should be put into literary works. So Matthew Arnold's critical work should be seen in this light as well. Friends, let us see this slide. You will see that he is having love for criticism and classical works, and its effect is seen on his writing. His critical works could be found especially on translating Homer. And Homer is a classical writer, and that is how we can see that his love for classical work is seen. And classicism requires some decorum, some authority, some of the following set rules and regulation, and he keeps all these things into mind. Slide please. And next to the translation of Homer, we have another book, that is a study of a Celtic literature and essays in criticism. That is a great book which you will find in 3 series, and it is a very monumental work. His judgment and critical writing is focused upon Wordsworth, Byron, and other writers as well. Now, into his prose work, because he is a neutral person, he does not give his own emotions or feelings while he criticizes the audience. So a kind of objectivity into his critical works could be seen. And there is a one word, disinterestedness. It means not his own self should come, or biases or personal feelings while judging the writer should come. So that sort of objectivity is found into work. Slide please. And you will see the word disinterestedness. He chose a fitting action for his subject, and whatever subject he chose, he always favored grand style, and he is having a kind of a criticism of life. And actually the term literature is reflection of time, or criticism of life is given by Arnold himself. So that is how he has the view to judge the life. And sometimes, no doubt, because of Victorian tendencies, he is tempted to give the moral tone, and it becomes very heavy. Now, these are the friends, very important writers. We have seen them, but it does not mean that there are not other writers as well. We have many writers, and many fields, prose is coming. For example, in literature, we have Walter Pater, John Simmons, Oscar Wilde, and Stevenson. On the other side, we also have historians, for example, J.A. Freud, John Green, and Freeman. We also have some scientists writing during the age, and that is Darwin. Darwin's work, is written to convey his journey. That was done on Beagle. And to southern part, whatever he went, when he went, he was not clear. But when he finished the journey and came back to England, he wrote the book and the experiences of Beagle. That is a great book. So here the scientist work is also coming in this age. And then the another book, that is Origin of Species, that has created uproar into literary and scientific fields, as well as in religious field also. Because of this, critical insight also came, and Victorian compromises, especially related to religion, came. So that very important book of Darwin, Origin of Species, also is found in this period. Slide please. Another writer, a scientist, is writing, that is Herbert Spencer and Thomas Huxley. And we also have one particular person, John Stuart Mill. His works is related for philosophy. So these are the very important other prose writers. And now we go to the last point of the our lecture, and that is you will see on the slide that when we see all these things, leading practitioners and important aspects of Victorian prose, we should not forget that everything is good. No doubt, basically the prose is very, very wonderful, but still we have some problems here. For example, as there are lots of writers writing, each writer has one particular mood or style, and because of that particular feeling, sometimes eccentricity also comes into the view. Another thing is ruggedness. The writer aims at presenting moral tone. As a result, he would not care for style or subject or particular giving argument or eloquence. He is making mistakes. Basically, he wishes to give the message, and as a result, he would not care for particular style. Another thing that you will see, that is a mannerism. From Ruskin to Matthew Arnold, and from Henry Newman, Cardinal Newman too, we have scientists. So the variety of writers brings mannerism into the way. Each writer's style, if you read, it will come to know. But then it becomes monotonous. A writer, when he is writing, he must have different ways to present the views. If he is not giving variety, then the writer would not be read by the audience. There would be not so much response. And as a result, slowly, the interest goes away. So mannerism is good as well as a demerit also. Slide, please. And then we also miss sanity and balance of the writers. And sometimes the writers became so much careful about their presentation, especially classical writers. There we are fed up with their over refinement. So my dear friends, these are the some of the issues which I have dealt with Victorian prose. As I told you, my purpose was to give you the information. I wanted to give you details, and as a result, we have no any critical analysis of the works. I hope that my lecture has helped you to understand the topic, and that is Victorian prose. If there is any query, I welcome it. Questions, if you have any.